Welcome back to an episode of TBD Spotlight. Normally, we interview someone from the community, a business owner, someone of interest, future girlfriend, you know, anything, anyone. But today, Josh and I, we are going to be interviewed by...
Kile Bradley. Hey guys, I'm from New Vision High School. I'm a senior this year and I'm doing a job shadow from these guys. They're doing a great job. I'm absolutely loving everything that's ever. I'm learning so much, and I've been here for an hour and a half maybe.
I appreciate that, man. Yeah.
Yeah.
We didn't tell him to say
that. Yeah. We actually do like interns actually. I feel like me and you like work better with interns, like because we want to like put the professional feel in, and so like our minute like mess ups, we don't highlight as much. Or we do, or we accentuate.
It's a good observation, Josh. Yeah. We've taken on interns from different colleges, NIC,
oh, really?
U of I, mm-hmm. and then LCSC.
Right on.
Mostly Travis, yeah. Apparently, you have a lot of intern.
The SEO for my website just beacons to the interns.
Well, I actually got referred to by a guy that I think his name is Robert or something like that. He was like, yeah, my buddy Travis, he does all this. Like, he'll take you. Like, you're gonna have so much fun.
Nice. It's gonna
be great.
Dude, see?
Awesome.
You're being talked about in the high schools even, brother.
Man, it feels so good.
I mean,
all it took was a quick Google search, but, you know.
I love it, yeah. No, we like that stuff, though. We liked it because, I mean, your experience so far is good, but you see the intricacies of what we do. Like, it is not just point-and-shoot media. Like we there's a lot of things that can happen. Like, for example, we don't hit record on the microphones, right? And we have to do that again.
Now, there's a lot that goes into it. And I mean, even though like it's much less intense than like a mm-hmm. college, like full on like internship job shadowing.
Right.
Like I think that, what is it, Tuesday, we're going to go do an FPV drone fly through. You got to watch a podcast be recorded from beginning to end. We're going to go edit it upstairs.
Mm-hmm.
A lot of hands-on.
Should probably let him get to his questions. Yeah. We're still in the podcast mode.
So yeah.
Josh and I don't know how to shut up.
Yeah.
Go ahead.
So we'll let you premise. Yeah. So
my first question is like, what drives you guys every day to just do this? Like, what is your main, just like person behind the wheel? Like what?
Like why?
Yeah.
You go first, brother.
I've always believed that there's a difference between like an entrepreneur mm-hmm. and a standard, like a person who just goes into their job every single day to do their job, like a standard worker.
Freelancer?
Freelancer or just a person who just works, you know. When you're an entrepreneur, you get that itch where it's like, it's so exciting, the drive, the push, mm-hmm. it's part of the whole reason why you are doing it. When I started my own business, I started running my own company and, you know, trying to piece it all together with the strategy and stuff. Like, my mom was freaked out. She's still freaked out. She's like, she took me aside one day and she's like, Travis, I don't know why you do what you do. And I don't think I would be able to do it, but that's just pretty, I'm proud of you. Like, thank you. It's really just, you know, there's that itch that you have to satisfy, mm-hmm. pushing and building something that's your own,
yeah.
having the freedom. And the risk is actually kind of exciting. It's hard to explain. I think in different podcasts, we've talked about how you don't have the same security as if you worked a 9-to-5, but being able to actually fight for your life to be what it could be, have no limits, push beyond what it...
Right.
There are no limits when you run your own company. There's always something more that you can actually achieve. And I like that a lot.
100%, yeah. Yeah, I mean, me, you know, I grew up super poor. I grew up in a very, very terrible childhood.
Yeah.
But in with me, I just, I with that, it became a really hard working work ethic. Anything I did was like hard labor work. You know, anything I did, I applied 200% effort into in hopes to be paid what I'm worth, right? And right. I came to find out that's not the case. And it was more times than not of doing trades and learning. Like, I became an elevator mechanic. You know, when I tell people that, they're like, what the f-? it's such a, like, what? Like, you don't want to work on elevators? Like,
this is for a school, so maybe.
Yeah.
You know, less words.
Okay? Less cursing.
Just not the hard ones. Just
not the hard ones. We'll bleep it out.
Which ones are the hard ones? Can you
tell them to us? No.
We can't bleep them.
But, you know, I would strive to, you know, work really hard to be paid for what I think I'm worth. And 9 times out of 10, that just wouldn't happen. And so I with how I am, I think outside the box with things, and I have severe ADHD, and people that are close to me know that. And but with that becomes more of, like, when I get focused on something, I'll give it all my all.
Right.
And I had a resentment of having somebody be in control of my life and my income. Mm-hmm. Because I would work exceptionally hard at things. And so it got me into the business mindset, where I was like, you know what, I want to do my own thing with something that I want to focus on and be paid for what I'm worth.
Right.
I wasn't naive in thinking I'm, you know, worth $1 million, but
yeah.
You know, I was like, if I can do good at something and get exceptionally well at it, I will be paid for what I'm worth.
Right.
And so that's what got me into entrepreneurship. I don't care about the nuance of entrepreneur. I want to be able to control my life.
Mm-hmm.
If I do something well and I learn something that is value to somebody else, I want to be paid for what I bring as value.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what I did to, that's what drives me. And plus I have 4 children, you know, right. I have 2 of my own and 2 with my, girlfriend, and I have a household that relies on income. My girlfriend makes a lot of money, but my life has always premised on, I want my children to be better off. So that also adds a level of, you know, accountability on my end to even work harder, even though I'm doing something for myself.
Right.
So there is no leeway for me to. So that's what drives me every single day is I love what I do. I like having control of my own life, my own schedule, my own everything. But there is also accountability that I've learned, where it isn't just rainbows and unicorns. I can just take off for a week or whatever.
Yeah.
I work exceptionally hard for what I like to do.
Right.
And then on that is all the responsibilities, but I have full control.
Yeah.
If I screw up, my income isn't as much as I want. That's on me.
Mm-hmm.
And I like that.
Yeah.
There's a lot of learning experience, but you know, anything bad with entrepreneurship, if you look at it as a just good, I screwed up. Good. I lost that client. Good.
Right.
I'm going to learn from that, and then I'm going to make myself better. I love that process.
You have to learn from everything.
Yeah.
Something I always used to say was that entrepreneur, people who have that mindset or that itch, that thing in their soul, they make the best employees, but it's...
to make the best employees, brother.
Because you take everything so hard. You're learning. You're striving. You're pushing. But most of the time they're short-term employees because it will never be enough.
Right.
They will reach that limit where they just aren't satisfied with how far they can go.
Yeah. Right.
And either they go back to school for like 6 years because then there's no cap until they switch up their brain or their mindset and want to try something new.
Right.
Right.
They make amazing employees, but most of the time short-term.
You won't keep them. Yeah.
Yeah. Because yeah. They will get bored.
Yeah, 100%. So
if they're not,
hopefully that answered the question.
Yeah. So basically, what I'm gathering is it's the aspect of being able to show the best of your capabilities on your own terms, mm-hmm. and then mm-hmm. like just seeing where it goes from there.
Like, freedom.
That's kind of what I'm giving. Yeah, the freedom.
Yep. All right. With accountability. Yeah.
Yeah, with accountability, obviously.
Mm-hmm.
Yep. RZ. So
freedom to succeed, freedom to fail. You know.
Oh my gosh, dude, there's a lot of failures.
Freedom to succeed, the risk of failure. But I mean, like, failure just means that you get to, you know,
yeah, I mean,
look back and try again
with
edit.
What's good in life doesn't come with risk, right? Like,
it doesn't come with
that. I could have literally made, you know, $200,000 a year being an elevator mechanic.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I would have been at that level of pay already.
Yeah.
But that still wouldn't, I would have been at a job where I hated. You know, I would, because that would be my, I would be capped.
Mm-hmm.
That's the whole thing. I don't want to be capped.
There are no limits when you're doing your own thing.
Right.
So, besides that, the small things, you know how like this, sometimes the small things that matter, right? Mm-hmm. What's your favorite part about this job that, what is your favorite part about this job? Like, doesn't like the small things.
Yeah.
I like to see businesses succeed.
Mm-hmm.
It doesn't sound small, but it's a very specific detail of what we do. It's really exciting to see a company grow and to be a part of that and to be able to own that and to be excited about a person's success and see it all come together. It's like, yeah, it's really cool.
I would say the best part is FPV. No, best part is actually the friendships I gather from it because you know, with me, I internalized the be surrounded by people like yourself or like-minded or better, right? And so with what I do and, you know, what we do on a daily basis, we have clients that make millions, right? We have clients that have ginormous businesses. But they become like really, like how we work, we become really good friends with them. Like we have a client now who we've established a relationship with that we go to barbecues with and we hang out with and we go to, you know, to hangouts with all the time. But this dude comes from a business that's a global multi-million dollar business, right?
Right.
But surrounding ourselves with that kind of people, that's the people that I resonate with more. I don't think any of my friends actually work like as a job. And that's the whole thing. It's like I resonate with people like Travis, like our clients that do things that I'm aligned with, but they strive for greatness, right? And they strive to make a better life for themselves and their children's children. And they talk about growth.
Right.
With hanging out. So it's the friendships and the relationships I build in terms of what I'm doing is what I love most.
That's so true.
Yeah, no, I'll have to agree with you there because, I mean, even like working on school projects in school, I'll get paired with someone that I've never talked to before, and then like we start like, you know, mingling, talking, all this other stuff, and it's like, well, this person's actually like pretty cool. Yeah. And it's like you would have never known if like that hadn't happened, and then that's like a missed opportunity.
Exactly. Yeah.
Well, like I feel like your friend group is always forged by your coworkers and whatnot, but our coworkers are infinite. Like the amount of friendships, I'd say 8 of my closest friends right now, which it's not easy to get friends as an adult when you aren't forced into the social stuff, have all come from work or connections or places I work, stuff like that. It's crazy. And I totally agree with that.
Yeah. 100%.
Awesome. So I'll kind of opposite question. What do you not like about this job? Like what's your least favorite part?
That's actually a really hard one.
What I don't like is the balance I have to force myself with my kids. So as a business owner, entrepreneur, there's times where your time is needed long, like for stretches, right? Like there's 2 weeks, 3 weeks, 4 weeks sometimes, right? Where you launch something or you do something and your time is needed to better your future, but in it's such a small minute part, but that within that small portion of your life you're still yearning to be involved as a parent,
right?
This is more niche because there are entrepreneurs that don't have kids, right? So their answer might be different, but in my experience is, you know, I have 4 children to, you know, that want to hang out with me, that wants time with me, that, you know, and then I have a partner that wants time with me and wants to, you know, but there's times where the business takes precedent of my time and it requires me to forego the fun aspects.
Mm-hmm.
That's what I hate the most. Yeah. And it's not a resentment hate. It's just like, it's a part of it and I accept it and people around me that accept it, my kids accept it, whatever, but, that's just not a fun thing, you know, because there's things that, like, I want to always be present with my family. And that's just, the reality is it's not as simple as that, right?
Right. The work-life balance can be really hard.
Yeah.
The, like, I
work, personal life.
As far as, like, the actual job, it's hard to point out a negative because, like we said, our failures become learning opportunities. The hard parts become something that I learn to appreciate because it's all part of the same thing. So it's hard for me to say, I don't like this, because tomorrow I will.
Yeah.
You know, I'm frustrated with this right now, but tomorrow it'll all be better because we'll have solved it. And I like the challenge of solving the things I don't like, and they quickly become things I do like. But the work-life balance, I mean, I've had girlfriends in the past that are just like, why are you staying up till 3 a.m. working on a video? You know, just upset about it. It's like, right. Listen. I have the flexibility to be able to pick up the kids from school, take care of them, check this, run this errand, do whatever I need to do whenever I need to do it. But the work has to get done.
Yeah.
So yeah, you have the flexibility, but you have no set work hours. And that's not a good thing sometimes, because
right.
there's no cutoff point.
Right.
If it has to get done, it has to get done. And, you know, reining in your personal time, your mental health time, getting up, like, enjoying what you're doing is important too. But, like, what was it, like, the last 4 weekends we were filming weddings and then doing other events, doing other networking stuff and working all week around the kids' schedule. Mm-hmm. Like, both of us have similar lives. And then I think this week was the first weekend where I'm like, okay, I'm not going to go enjoy this time with my friends. I'm actually going to be home.
Yeah.
And, like, take a nap, because holy crap, too much.
Yeah.
You know, it's very hard to walk that line.
Mm-hmm.
I totally agree with Josh.
Yeah.
All right. So, I mean, I can definitely agree with most of that because, like, you know, between balancing personal life, like, even just me as a cook at Denny's, like, I have to be at work, and then I work with one of my best friends, and we have to keep that separate. So, like, when we're at work, we don't talk to each other. We don't, like, go out on breaks with each other. Like, when we're there to work, and honestly kind of avoid each other because we know it's a stressful job, and if we get in each other's way, fists might start throwing.
Yep.
Oh, damn.
That's just our friendship, though. But I mean, like, outside of work, we can do everything off together.
And do whatever.
Yeah, just do absolutely whatever. So I feel like it's important to have that difference, or whatever the word is. I don't know. But yeah.
Separation.
Yeah, the separation.
Yeah.
So what skill set do you think is needed for this job, for this career?
There's a lot of niches. Like, for me,
it's a media specific.
Media specific to, like, what
or marketing,
whatever it is that you guys, it's marketing, right?
Yeah, it's media, it's a marketing company, but what brought you to us, was it seeking out media?
The media part, yes. So I guess media,
I would say having an eye for it is required. You can go to school for years to learn what you would just know if you played with the camera enough. And you have that eye of detail, and you know what looks good, and you pay attention, and you watch enough stuff to get excited about it. That's how I feel about, you know, what do you need to do this job? You have to want to do the job,
right?
And practice and play and be passionate about it.
Okay.
We've been answering everything as entrepreneurs, so
I mean, I would say just doing it.
Yeah,
like, you, the amount of stuff that I know how to do, you'll never learn at a school, at a trade, or anything, because you learn by doing, right? So whatever you want to do, and that applies to everything, right? Unless you're a brain surgeon or, like, a different category.
At least you'd hope.
Yeah, at least you'd hope. But, like, in terms of media and marketing, you can watch all the videos. You can binge watch YouTube. You can go to school for it. You can shadow as many people as you want. You'll never actually learn until you do. As simple as that. Right. The willingness to do it.
Yeah.
Right.
And I mean, there was a time when I was first starting where I'd get a new camera, a new toy, for the business, but I wouldn't use it until I was in the field because I like the rush of learning it right then and there. It was very stupid, very, very dumb. But God, like getting, because every job we would do when my company first started, we'd buy a new piece of equipment and it would just be adding to the arsenal, building something and having it and learning and learning and in the field and playing with it. And then it's exciting. And having that like passion for it and getting excited about what you're doing is a really big deal.
Yeah. Right. So would you say that also like having an eye for detail is an important
As part of the talent.
Yeah, as part of the talent goes, like having an eye for detail, being able to
Like an eye for detail, but
if you're creating media.
When you're creating media, it's not an eye for detail, it's an eye for creativity, right? So, you know, detail comes with the expertise.
Right.
It's an eye for creativity, an eye for thinking of things outside the box, being different, doing different transitions, using different camera equipment, using different lighting situations, being on the top. Like we had the giant light right here, right? Mm-hmm. That was facing it. Like that's a standard 3-light key where we're like, we turn that off. We're like, oh, looks way better with just 2 lights, right?
Yeah.
I think being just creative enough to do your own thing and seeing what you like to do that looks good in the eye of other people, right? Right. Like eye for details, that just comes along with the job.
Yeah, I think appreciating the details because there's so much, like, I think part of what he's saying is like the ability to notice and see those things.
Yeah, that's,
It's very important because if you're a person who just doesn't, like it does not compute, it is what it is.
Right.
Like, then you're not going to be able to adjust those details, you know?
True.
Yeah, like how you were saying earlier, like you're the one that kind of just like sets everything up and correct me if I'm wrong on that. You were talking about that earlier?
I'm the nerd.
Yeah, the nerd.
Yeah, I'm the nerd who does...
With his algorithms.
With my algorithms, you know. But yeah, in the business, you know, I'm the more analytical person for what we do in marketing, right? And then Travis is the more creative one and attention to detail in terms of like what's being produced.
Right. But there's a difference between like number details, like the nitty gritty of analytical work, and then a person who's like looking at something like, the 2D fruity, like floaty, this is what your brand means. This is the expression of the psychology behind it. And yeah, I like getting deep with that in that regard with a brand, and it has a place in marketing because it can be very important.
Yeah.
But if you don't know how to interpret the numbers, it's very interesting because we both have a very, very keen attention to detail, but they're flip-flopped and opposite
right.
in certain ways. And then we meet in the middle in a lot of other things too.
100%. Yeah.
Like when we talk about marketing, when we talk about branding, we pivot off each other constantly because we have like, we're looking at it from two different directions while knowing everything that happens in the middle.
Right.
And it's really cool to have a business partner like that.
Right.
It's actually really important.
Mm-hmm. 100%.
Can definitely see why I work best with when I'm working with other people, mainly like one other person or like two.
You
other
have
people.
To have someone who's going to point stuff out to you that you just it's in your blind spot.
Yeah, right. It's important to have
and no ego, right? No right. ego of oh I know it all.
Yeah,
right. Like I like with our business, I know Travis is way better than me at media than I will ever be. I'm good. I'm a professional, but he enjoys it more and he does more of it. Where I trust him wholeheartedly to do all the media.
Right.
Right. Vice versa. He doesn't want to know my, Google ads or Facebook ads or how to set things up.
To sell it.
But like he has trust that I know what I'm doing and he has no ego to tell people that like, no, that I'm not the guy that you want to talk to. Same with me with media. I'm not the guy you want to talk to this guy.
Yeah.
Right. So attention to detail is with what we do in our own realm. And we meet in the middle, but also ego plays a big part in that attention to details. You are never going to be the best overall with, as long as you have that mindset of like, there's, when you talk to other people, you can learn from other people.
There will never not be something new to learn.
Right.
And like, we're not the best. We work our hardest to be the best that we can be. But as far as out there, there's always someone better than you. at whatever industry that you're in.
That's what drives the society.
Mm-hmm. Yep. Yeah. Absolutely. And you just, if you just gotta not lay down and die, you just gotta keep on going.
Exactly.
So specifically starting out, like when you guys joined your businesses, what was the hardest obstacle to get past?
I don't know. I mean, basically just deciding when it was going to happen. Both of the services and our specialities are so important, but they're valued differently in the industry. So like some things are more reoccurring and higher value, and then some things are not. And I think it's been finding the intricacies of how to bring it all together, present it together all the time, and then basically discover job roles, because I'd say we're scaling much faster than I expected us to, but we're also focused. And I think it's just been finding our footing and our focus on the direction that we're going and what roles to play, because I'm not just the media guy. You know, and also we were both business owners.
Yeah.
So now being co-business owners and not doing everything ourselves all the time and trying to bring more people in, rely on each other, rely on our employees, that's hard to conceptualize when you've been fighting for your future as the only thing of defense, the only person who can do it. I think we've both struggled with that.
No, 100%. Yeah, the hardest part is scaling, in my opinion.
Understanding your changing roles.
Yeah, you can be the best at what you do, and you can, like Trevor said, we came as business owners. We both did good at our own roles of our own business, but having like a business that wants to scale past you, that's been the biggest challenge, because then I have to rely on other people. I have to rely on people I hire, on people that I trust with a job that I'm used to doing myself, or then, vice versa, teaching them how to do what I do with, standard operating procedures or whatever. Like the whole scaling process of having more work than I can ever fathom doing myself has been the biggest challenge, because now we're at that point where we have so much work that neither of us can do it on our own, because we hired and then we taught and then we have these people, in place, and then it's just, and then it's us, and then more clients, all of that combined, we can't physically have the time to do that on our own. We just can't, because we got a cap, and then we broke the cap and went above and beyond what one person can handle.
Yeah.
That whole nuance has been the biggest challenge, and it is still a challenge ongoing. It's always going to be an ongoing challenge.
Yeah.
But that is the biggest challenge, or the biggest thing that's the hardest thing of what we do, is getting to the point where you get to a certain level of what you can handle, and then breaking through that and relying on others to help facilitate what you've built.
Right.
Well, and the hardest part about that too is that as I grew up, I started to part of what my goal and my perspective on the decisions that I would make is I would not put my fate or rely on another person, because I wanted it to be all on me. So if I failed, I could learn a lesson, and they could be calculated failures, right?
Right.
Because I was a perpetual planner. So now to be like, actually, if you want to be able to plan as big as you want to plan, you need to put your fate in the hands of others as well. Mm-hmm. Yeah. You're like, I don't know about that. Because if you trust someone and you give them part of, if you have to have that amount of trust to, in order to do as much as you want to do, you are also just totally accepting that this is now outside of your control.
Yeah.
And your failure, if they fail, will be you learning, oh, well, I should have taught this person differently.
Yeah. It's way different.
It's a whole different mindset. And that's been the hardest part of this company venture that we've been working towards,
So would you say that there's a difference between growth and scaling, kind of?
I mean, scaling is the corporate word for growth.
Okay.
Yeah.
So it's just maximizing potential of your company and how far the profit margin will scale, and if you're going to get like super nitty gritty about it, how the company.
Yeah, they go hand in hand, right? When you're scaling, you're growing. There's a cap that one person can do. You can't grow past what you're capable of doing physically, right? So
right.
Well, yeah, you know, everything takes a certain amount of time. Just like an employee trades their time for money in the standard job, we have to calculate out the amount of time that we can spend before we start.
Now we have to trade money for time.
Right. I mean, all things in moderation. You can't, you know, be reaching to the moon and stuff, like trying to give yourself more work than even two people can handle, because otherwise that's just, you're setting yourself up for failure at that
point. You have that goal, but with a growing mindset, you hire another person, train another person. You always have to the moon mindset.
Okay.
And you keep going and you just figure it out.
It's just there are new problems to find new solutions to. And that's part of the perpetual growth. To be ready to confront those new problems that come up, because it's going to be way different than what it was years ago when it was just you and trying to figure out how to edit that damn video. Or we're going to bleep all these out. It's going to be fine.
Those are fine. Oh, it's just pretty much like the F mode.
Can you tell us which words those are?
I would just bleep out every curse word, because it'd be even more funny when you watch it.
Yeah, that would be funny.
Every time we bleep out curse words on Even Our Podcast, it was like the best podcast.
It was pretty funny.
The clip is ever. We're like, beep.
The biggest things are just like, and yes.
Oh, we're bleeping out.
He did it.
We're bleeping out. We coerced him.
They're never going to let another student come back. All right. Next question.
Let's see. It's kind of stupid, because the questions that my teacher laid out for me are like similar questions, and you guys have pretty much answered all of them.
Sure.
With just your explanations. Mm-hmm. So I'm just going to go off of like my own.
Sure.
Let's see.
Oh, they're in his head, people.
Yeah, they're in my head.
This is exciting.
Oh my gosh.
Going off script.
Oh, man.
I'm a little nervous.
I thought of one earlier, but I don't remember it.
That's not helpful.
we were talking about the...
I might remember it.
No. like the balances and stuff like that between work and life. It was... Yeah. Okay, I remember. So if you, like, let's just say a scenario question. You guys are filming a video and some emergencies happening with your family or outside of, like, in your personal life. Mm-hmm. How are you supposed to react to that? Like, do you just sort of drop everything you're doing, or, like, hit pause? Like, how does that work?
It depends. I mean, it's always nice to have a support system.
Yeah. You know,
like Devin has his girlfriend, I have my family and my brother and stuff like that. Or you have...
I have Devin, yeah.
You have Devin, who is your girlfriend. I got flip-flopped there for a second. Anyway, but, you know, I mean, in one way, we have the freedom to tell the client, hey, and if it's a commercial client, it's not usually that big of a deal. Right. There's an emergency, you just let them know. We don't have to ask the boss, we tell the client. There's a big difference between a client relationship and a boss-employee relationship.
Right.
Okay.
Our clients, we run the show just as much as they hired us to.
Right.
They can fire us, we can fire them. Mm-hmm. There's a mutual respect. So if something's going on in their life and they had to drop, like, reschedule filming,
right,
we would be like, okay.
Have to pivot,
and then we'd expect the same from them. And that's why we choose our clients. If we had a client who threatened us when we had to go take care of something, an emergency for our kid, probably not someone that we want a long-term relationship.
Yeah, probably.
Especially the hierarchy, right? Like, if there's like a, let's say a wedding. Like, you can't get around. We would just hire people to do, you know.
So if we're at the wedding, there's an emergency, then we're both there. And if we know that we can handle it without, the person with the emergency will go.
Well, have redundancy.
Or.
But if it's a question, hey, what's going on with this? You know, and they're like, well, you didn't get back to me yesterday. It's like, well, I had, you know, like, hey, I apologize. We had blah, 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 this happened. If they're not willing to be on a respectful, like, as an entrepreneur, because you're as, you know, like, employees are very different.
Right.
If you work somewhere, like you work at Denny's.
Yeah.
You can't just, you know, can't just take off. You know, you have to get approvals, and your boss expects you to be there, and then you know, that's different.
Yeah.
Right? We have employees, we expect our employees to do stuff. We we do manage our employees a bit differently. We give them autonomy. Not all businesses can do that. But, like, you know, you have a different expectation. As an entrepreneur, life can happen. We're always on the clock. So that means, like, if something happens, we have to go. Yeah. Right? We have to do something with the family, like work-life balance. Our kids are sick, we have to pick them up from school, whatever. If it is an important thing, we just pivot, right? We'll get somebody else to cover. I'll call Travis to see what he's doing, or we'll hire a freelancer to do it, whatever. So then our profit goes down from the job, but you know what? The client's happy if it's something an emergency basis. Right. There's always something we can do.
Well, and it's been nice having a partner too.
Yeah.
Because it's not all on one person's shoulders.
Right.
That there's been multiple meetings where I'll cover for Josh, or there's been filmings where it's like, hey, Josh, I have to do this. We'll cover for each other. And then having good support in business and in life is really helpful. I've called up my family so many times when there's a late night filming thing to watch my daughter for me, to help me out.
Mm-hmm.
Or yeah, either way, you just, mm-hmm. you build yourself up and you build the life where you have the support you need, whether it's in business or in your personal life.
Yeah.
And that's how you solve that problem.
Yeah, if you don't have kids, I mean, you're like, it's just wherever your life's at, right? Like if you're in high school,
yeah.
you get out of high school, just you, single dude, your work-life balance is more free, right? Like you don't have as much responsibility of like life.
Yeah.
So you can say, hey, dude, we can't hang out tonight. We can't, like, have, like, a, you know, can't come over and, like, play video games with me or whatever, right?
Right.
Whereas, like, when you have children, different story, right? Like, so your life, wherever your life's at, you have to make sure you have those redundancies depending on where you're at in your business or as an entrepreneur. When you work, same thing. You make sure that you have a support system, like, hey, if this happens, can you take over? You have to think ahead, right?
And yeah,
if all else fails, you're...
Yeah.
The people that you work with or you work for, they'll understand if you are at a net zero of other venues to go off of.
Right. Gaming. Yeah. And you have to surround yourself with people who understand.
Okay.
Like your lifestyle. If you're an entrepreneur, you have a specific lifestyle and like girlfriends, friends, stuff like that. You may be able to be super, super available or super, super not. They have to like understand that.
Mm-hmm.
If they're going to be in your life,
right?
You know, so
yeah. And then another one that I thought of is, what's something that somebody like, how do I word this? What's something you wish you knew going into all of this? Like something that somebody might have that should have told you about all of this and whatnot. If that makes sense.
Well.
How cool FPV drones would be.
How cool FPV drones would have been. I would have made a whole freaking channel about, I don't know. I think if the one thing, if somebody told me how to manage, if somebody told me to or like convinced me, I guess, to utilize the money I make by paying other people to do what I do, so I can have more time to build a business. I think earlier that would have been a great thing for me to learn. Even though I knew it, mm-hmm. it was if I had somebody in my corner saying, dude, use that money, pay somebody to do this and have them do it so you can have more time and freedom to do the things that make your business bigger. I think I've been doing this for 13 years like and it's only been in the last...
Scaling mindset earlier on. Correct.
Yeah, because really, I was always like, no, I'm going to be control. I'm the best. I'm the, I know if I had agreed. That earlier, bro, I'd been like, I don't know where I'd be if I leveraged off work and then had more time to scale. I don't know where I'd be because it's only been the last couple of years we've been really focused on doing that. But it's, I knew that's what you needed to do, but it was the, I'll do that later. If I had somebody in my corner telling me, nope, you got paid to do this. This part of this money is going to go towards this person doing it. You're going to go and spend your time getting other clients. That would have probably helped me tremendously in the 13 years I've been freaking doing this. Well,
part of that, at least for me, is that pride of feeling like everything needs to be touched and done specifically by me in order to be done right. Like, I do good work, but I'm not like perfect. And there are plenty of people who do just as good or better.
Right.
It's like being able to let go and then still maintain quality, but not have to have your finger in every pie.
Right.
You don't have to have your hands on every single wheel. Just let, you have to be able to trust the people that you're putting in place, your partners, your employees. That would be, I totally agree with Josh, because every single lesson I've learned as far as like, because...
Yeah, I'm glad I didn't get told of all the mistakes I made, to be honest.
Right. Well, and I like making those mistakes. All the, like, even with editing, you edit so many different videos over time, you learn so much, every single one. And then I'm the guy who watches those old videos. I'm like, I hate this part. I hate this part. I hate that part. That part sucks. It's so important because you have to be your biggest critic so you can learn and do things better and better and better. If you're not doing your best or striving to do your best next time, what's the point?
Right.
And I think maybe a lot of entrepreneurs have that mindset too. Maybe not, but that's been my mindset for as long as I can.
That's the best, right? Learning from mistakes, brother, makes you learn real quick.
Yeah,
it's just having somebody tell you the nuancey, like, back end things of like, hey bro, you're gonna get really good at what you do and you're gonna get capped out, and then you're gonna focus on it. It's gonna be harder. If I was like preemptively doing this, that would have been nice.
Though, I feel like that's almost part of the journey too.
Yeah, that's good.
If you would have been in that mindset early on before you knew well enough how to teach people to do what you do, it's almost like everything's happening in the time it needs to happen. But it would be nice to have that mindset early on.
Yeah.
I still need somebody to tell me, okay, you don't have to do this yourself. Although it is nice to be like, okay, editor, you're fired. I'll do it myself.
Yes. Yeah. Yes.
I will do it myself.
Yeah, I'll do it myself. You always have yourself to draw back. But yeah, that'd be, you know, for me, that'd be the one thing that I would look back on and say, that'd be nice to have a person telling me that, so.
Mm-hmm. Okay. And then kind of more a question for you specifically, since you're just on like the media part of it.
Yeah.
What made you want to enter this kind of career? Like,
the media side?
Yeah.
Well, let's see. I started...
You had an OnlyFans account.
And, hey. That's been privated for years. Okay. For years. Well, so I was part of a, I was working at the hospital, and they'd have a competition on between all the different nursing units on who could make the funniest video. And then on Nurses Day, they would show them to everybody and the people would vote for their favorite video. And then I liked it. I had a lot of fun with it. You know, I made silly YouTube videos when I was a kid. So I, whatever unit I belonged to, they would win every year as I moved around the hospital. And then other units started asking me if I would volunteer to film and produce and edit their videos too, because there's such higher quality than a person who did an old nurse not knowing how to hold the phone. So I started getting a reputation around the hospital, and then I had a couple nurses ask me to film their wedding. And I was like, oh, this could be a career path. I'm like, I don't have a real camera. I just have my iPhone. So then I got two high school people who needed their job shadowing hours. My brother and his friend, who were about to graduate high school, they agreed to help me film a wedding. And then we had three weddings in 2 days as the first weddings we ever did. And then I realized that doing it on iPhones is probably not the best idea. So I went out with no portfolio, no examples, and started meeting people in coffee shops and posting on Shop and Swap, hey, I'll film your wedding for $500. And I showed them my list of shots that we planned to get with iPhones, where we would sit in the audience in order to get these shots, how we would get the little magnifying glass that then goes over the phone so we could zoom a little bit, how we would make sure someone was sitting close enough to get the audio. All with the plan to use iPhones. Well, we booked so many weddings that we were able to buy a Mac computer and a DSLR camera before the first wedding. So I hustled enough to book enough so we could have real equipment before we ever had to film. And then after that, every single wedding, we'd buy a new piece of equipment. And then several times rebranding and working on the eloquencies of my brand, I started to really see, well, I can build a website and create a commercial and create a color scheme and build a logo myself, why don't I offer all these services as well? And several more years later, Josh and I met. And that's kind of how it all came to be. Got into media, just people asked me to do it. I think my ex-wife at one point said, you like this so much, you should work in media. And I'm like, how am I going to get a job making movies in North Idaho? Like, that's not even a possibility. I shot herself down.
Right.
I shot her down, and I'm like, but then life happened.
And you actually did.
We're here now.
Yeah, and now here we are in a dedicated studio
marketing company with our own podcast,
a brand new backdrop,
beautiful backdrop. Yeah. So much has happened, and you know, you were right, by the way. So she's gonna appreciate hearing that. I'm sure she's one of our seven people that watch the other show.
You know what though? You say that, brother. But like, I've been posting so many videos, dude. Like, bringing like thousands of people seeing it. I'm like, I don't know, man.
Yeah, drive this traffic to what we need them to watch.
Yeah.
The stuff we put hours into.
Well, you know who else might watch this? The deans of graduation, or whatever their names are. They're basically
Send us more interns.
Yep.
Yeah.
People that monitor the graduate students, and you know, they run the graduation ceremony and stuff like that.
Oh, nice. They're the ones that we're bleeping the words for.
Yes.
When I ask to tell me which words weren't allowed while on air. It's okay. They appreciate a good sense of humor, I'm sure.
I
know one of them.
This will probably be a nice hit.
Yeah. Well, they'll love us.
I think you chose a pretty eccentric group of people to do this with.
Like I said, either we'll suddenly all...
Listen, I was a terrible... I was a student that every teacher hated but loved at the same time, because I didn't do things that were interrupting, but I was just... I did just enough in school to pass... And so they hated me for that, but they loved me because of who I was.
See, I had average grades, but it was because I liked the rush of needing to finish the assignment the night before or on the way to school. I loved that.
Yeah.
And it was bad. It was bad because I knew the stuff. I do the work fine, but I liked the rush of being under a deadline. It was so weird.
I just never did homework. I didn't do anything else except I took the test, and like the only thing that carried me in high school was math. That was it.
Seriously?
I'm a math whiz. And so I would go in there, I would watch the teacher do it on the board, and then I would just learn how to do it. And then, like, on the test days, I would just write the answers because I can see it. And the teachers thought I was cheating, so they would give me separate tests, send me the back, and nothing worked. And they realized that I wasn't cheating. But they hated me for that because they would do all this work as a teacher to give you lessons and try to, like, help you work through problems. And I'm just, like, showing up, like, not doing anything in class and just writing the answers down.
Which is fun in high school. But what really sucked was in college, because I was bored, even though it was difficult for me to get it. And I was in college, like algebra or something. And I was like, okay, that's fine that that's your solution, but let me see how I can find my solutions. And I would like find ways to retroactively solve the problem to come up with the same answer.
They didn't like that.
In a much more difficult way than the way they were trying to teach me, but I didn't like being taught that way.
I didn't go to college, so.
Yeah, it was interesting.
I don't know that realm.
I dropped out to create a media company.
I know. Yeah, I didn't go to college. I just did trade work.
I studied journalism and
psychology. I think most entrepreneurs
use it every day.
Aren't college, like, bachelor, master's degree holders most of the time. There are some, but I think most of them.
If anything, I'd go for a bit. I don't know. I studied journalism and psychology, and it's really useful now. But I would have been like a business major. But it came to the point where it's like, hey, I got a kid at home. I have several more years to get my psych degree. I have this company I started. Do I want to go here and spend money, or do I want to go make money? Because I have people trying to give me money, and I don't have enough time to do everything. So I had to make a choice, and I jumped straight into
your philosophy. It was much more mature. I just didn't like school, so I didn't go. I wanted to make money somehow, other ways.
Did you have any more questions for us?
I've got three more questions.
Three more. All right.
All right.
So I do that so it's not too long of a video for them to actually watch it.
All right. So
honestly, though, this is probably more entertaining than most.
Yeah. Well, I mean, it's going to make a great TBD Spotlight episode either way.
Most. Yeah. You can clip this out.
I'm glad I could help.
Thank you.
We're just going to monetize you. No worries.
We needed someone to interview us.
We needed someone to interview us.
All right. So what's something that people don't know about this kind of stuff? Like a lot of people don't know that they should consider.
Of what specifically?
Of just the marketing and media aspect.
So much.
There's so much.
Like one thing.
That's something that most people don't know.
Most people don't know.
That, I mean, in this area, that it's needed.
That they can make money.
That the whole point
that they need to invest in the marketing.
The whole point is that what you're paying in, you will make more back. Like, that's the way marketing works. Like, people don't market because they think that if they do that, I can't afford to do that. Well, the whole point is that you're paying for this ad and you're making more back.
Most of them get intertwined with people that don't know what they're doing.
That's true. That's
so
true.
So how to pick the right company, mm-hmm. how to pick the right people to do what we do.
And there are good ones out there.
There are good ones out
there. We network with pretty much every one of the major marketing companies in this area. And that we have a giant referral network.
Right.
Because we know we're not a perfect fit for everybody. But people don't know how to interview and select the marketing company that's going to work best for them.
Right.
I think that's the best answer right there. How to know who you need to work with, or how to know if they know what they're talking about. Because you're supposed to, you do marketing, you make money with the marketing, and then you reinvest percentage of that profit into the marketing every single month.
ROI.
Yes, return on investment.
Really, ROI?
Yeah, return on investment.
Or ROAS, return on ad spend. That's more of what I deal with.
You're an investment. Just go with ROI.
I'll just make this my last question then.
You see the nerdiness. It's coming out.
My question is, do you guys have any questions for me?
Ooh, okay.
Oh,
I do. As you're in high school, what, because I'm still pretty young, I'm 29, but like when I was in high school, I was not taught how to be an entrepreneur or taught how to do trade or whatever. I was taught to get a career, go to college, get a degree, and then, you know, pursue whatever that degree. So as a student in high school, I guess, what is your mindset in the future? Like, what were you taught throughout high school, like, if you were, that your future path, what are you more geared towards doing? And are you wanting to explore, are you comfortable with the knowledge that you've gathered from high school of what you were told to pursue out of the box scenarios of having a career?
You want me to rephrase that?
No, I think I got the question. No, you can if you want to.
Do you feel like what you've learned in high school has prepared you with what you need to follow the path that you want? And what is that path?
Oh, I feel like 30% of what I learned in high school is set me up to what I want to do, if I'm being completely honest.
And what is that?
At the beginning of my high school year, I took a marketing class, and I still kind of remember a handful of stuff from that class, but also like communications and... you know, obviously, like, other language, or mm-hmm. like, English stuff, but, like, as far as this specific career goes, like, school, at least my high school, it, you know, they don't talk about this stuff, especially since it's a smaller school.
Yeah. Do you feel like, in Josh's experience, and mine too, I don't know, I weird high school private, public.
I wasn't taught how to do this.
Was the attitude for entrepreneurship, it's become a lot more popular in mm-hmm. the mainstream. We were wondering, in your high school experience, do they validate entrepreneurship as an option? Or is it assumed that you need to go into one of these standard career paths?
It's honestly, it's from my personal experience, the entrepreneurship aspect of like careers, it's been overlooked.
Really?
It's been overlooked completely. Still. They don't really promote it. They don't diss on it. They're like,
well, like job fairs. Have you done job
fairs? And no offense to the school, obviously,
right.
Because this is something that is widespread across mm-hmm. most schools. At least I went to public and private.
Mm-hmm.
Josh, most public.
All public, yeah.
But the attitude towards entrepreneurship, even being an option mm-hmm. for people, I can't imagine how many different people that would be amazing entrepreneurs end up going and just working for the man,
yeah.
working in a standard job,
yeah.
because they're never taught it's an option to own something.
Right.
Well, because like, when people talk to us, they're like, you know, we talk about business as like, you know, for example, I went on a trip with my partner, and then we go and we went to Leavenworth, and there's this river. And because of the knowledge and experience that I've gathered, that river has a beginning and an end.
Right.
And I was like, man, if we lived, we should retire here. And when we do, I'm going to open up a business of just picking people up from that end, which is like a mile and a half away. And I'm going to drive them back to their starting point or whatever. And I'm going to charge every person $10 to ride that with their family. That'll be the easiest thing. And then she looks at me, she's like, how do you just come up with that? I'm like, that'd be the easiest, but that would literally be the most scale. Like, I could hire somebody to drive, go there, and just pick people up back and forth all freaking day.
You're right? Just like, that just comes.
And that was just like, I was just like, I don't know. I just looked at it.
Dude, it never turns off. I was talking to a musician friend the other day, and he's like, you know, I'm going to study and figure out how, because he's an entrepreneur too. He's studied marketing and business and all that. He's like, I'm going to learn how to break down how to succeed in the music industry, from what you need to do to how to be scheduled, how to keep your schedule set, how to upload in a specific way, how to optimize your performance to get it out there, do what a label would do for you, for myself, so I can help teach other people. I'm like, well, how are you going to market that? Or like, right. Well, what's your, I'm like, oh yeah, then you can write it all down and turn it into a guide and then sell that. He's like, well, I'm not doing it for profit. I'm like, dude, if you're going to spend all of the time learning this, like, you could easily make a checklist thing and help by doing it. And then we got into a whole conversation. He's like, well, I want to give it.
Whatever.
And I'm like, yeah, but then it won't be taken seriously. And then you won't be able to push it out for the people to reach.
Right.
Like, how many people, anyway, we got into a big, long conversation, and I got what he was saying, but also, like, people like us, especially with the experiences we've mm-hmm. had, it's so exciting and life-giving to talk about opportunity mm-hmm. and what could happen if you bet on yourself, or if you push, be willing to fail.
Yeah.
It's awesome.
Which is what premises on the question. I'm like, you know, schools aren't geared towards, you know, teaching people how to make money by themselves. Like, I that's not the goal of the school.
Yeah.
But, you know, back, you know, I would feel like, if I had more resources,
I wish there was like an entrepreneur,
then there'd be more of an answer for me, because when it was like college day or whatever, and my friends were all doing that, so I wasn't doing that. My backup plan was going to community college and getting an associate's degree and then applying to whatever the frick job. But like, you know, I didn't have the resources to know maybe you're not, you know, the person that needs to work, because most people are okay just getting a career, and that's totally fine. That's
yeah,
we're not saying that's bad.
People need to work.
I wish I would have known, or somebody would have told me, like, maybe you should try being this. Maybe you should try doing this for your career, because you have you seem like a person that would excel in this category. I don't have that resources when I was going to school, mm-hmm. so I was curious to see your perspective, because as you were coming to us, you're interviewing entrepreneurs. I didn't even do that, in high school, but like, you're interested in this aspect of, you know, media. You can totally work for a company doing it too.
Yeah.
But like, you're asking us a lot of entrepreneur questions, so that's why I was kind of curious if
actually we're answering a lot of entrepreneurial answers. the questions have been.
Well, I mean, the entrepreneurship questions and the media questions, I feel like they kind of go hand in hand, mm-hmm. because mm-hmm. you're talking about your accomplishments that you've made. of entrepreneurship through marketing and media.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, there's no way to separate them. Yeah.
Right.
And then I know I said that was the last question, but this is my last one. Man,
go for it.
If you could do it all over again, would you choose a different career or would you stick with this one?
No.
This is it. Yep.
The only thing that I would change is just what's going to happen in the future. I love opportunity. Mm-hmm. I love recognizing it and seizing it. I love preparing and watching for all of the things that I need to do to be responsible to be able to seize that opportunity. And I want to own more businesses and just keep going. I don't think I'll ever retire fully. Right. There will just be more work in a different way.
Yeah.
Because this is my passion.
Right.
Yeah. I wouldn't change anything. Every single hardship I've been through has gotten me to being 29 and having a family. I can take any idea, like the knowledge and all the stuff that I've learned, I can literally just create a business and make $10,000 a month instantly. Like, I have that knowledge to be able to do that at any time. I'll never be broke. You know, I could be broke by my business failing, but I would get the knowledge I have, I would just create another business.
Yep.
I would do another thing. Mm-hmm. But that's because of all the stuff that I went through. All the stuff that I've been through, of all the times I've been at my lowest lows and my highest highs, and in terms of this whole path that I've taken, I've learned so much that I have the knowledge and skill sets to do anything I want to do and have a financial stability for my family at all times.
Right. Yeah.
So I wouldn't change anything.
That's good. Absolutely. To know. Well, that's all the questions I have for you, gentlemen. Thank you. I appreciate your time.
Yeah,
man.
Thanks
for coming in.
Yeah. Thanks for the questions too.
Sure. And thank you, random person who decided to watch this.
Thank you.
This has been the TBD Spotlight.